Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello and happy Friday to you, everybody. The final Friday of 2016, a day many people are probably very happy to see, although I don't know if 2017 will be any better. Personally and professionally and creatively, 2016 for me has been amazing for all other reasons, and for everyone else, for reasons I don't need to go into, has been absolutely terrible in many ways. But I thought I would end the year on an incredibly high note. I am putting out one final episode of the year, and my guest is the one and only Mr. Steve Albini. Steve is one of the people, if not the person, I probably admire most in the world of creative arts, and to come out of the punk rock scene. You may know Steve from his bands, including Big Black and Shellac, two bands that are some of my absolute favorites. He was also in a band called Rape Man. Big Black are one of the bands that I constantly revisit. Their album Songs About Fucking. I should mention this episode does have swearing in it, everybody, so you probably already knew that by now, because I said songs about fucking, and fucking is a swear. But all of their records are great, but that record in particular is one that I revisit often and was on my record player as a teenager nonstop. There's a chain of record stores here in New England called Newbury Comics, and I had that record in my hand probably 20 times, and was always waiting for the cashier to be a guy. For some reason, I was embarrassed to purchase that record from one of the female cashiers. I was a teenager. There were hormones involved. The album cover has some very funny, not quite explicit sort of anime drawings on it. And eventually I discovered mail order in the pre-internet age and was able to obtain that record. And thank God that I did. I mean, just this precious thing on that record is probably one of my favorite songs ever. Easily in my top five. But Steve is in those bands. Steve also is known for his production and engineering work. You may have known that already, but if you didn't, he's produced so many incredible things. He likes to be called an engineer. He's engineered them. Nirvana's In Utero, The Pixies, PJ Harvey, Jawbreaker, the list goes on and on and on. He is one of the smartest people I've ever had the pleasure of talking to, and one of the reasons I admire him so incredibly much is because, as someone who also came up in the punk rock scene, Steve is uncompromising in his ideals, and he's managed to be very successful in what he does in the creative arts while completely sticking to the sort of ethos of punk rock. And that is incredibly admirable, and it is something I strive for when I was doing music and when I do comedy and when I've been doing this podcast. And so he is a true inspiration for me, and it was an amazing way to end the year to be able to talk to him. And I want to thank him so very much for taking the time to do that. He's incredibly busy, and it was so nice of him to take some time out of his schedule to talk to me. If you have the means, go see Shellac. They just ended a little tour, but they tour sort of infrequently, but go out of your way to see them. They are just an incredible live band. My favorite Shellac record is 1000 Hertz. If you need to purchase just one record, I highly recommend you purchase that one. So anyway, I talked to Steve about television and music, and if you're checking out this show for the first time because of my guest, you have very good taste. But my name is Ken Reed. I am a stand-up comedian from Boston, Mass. This show is TV Guidance Counselor. Normally on the show, the basic format is I own more or less every issue of TV Guide. Somebody picks an old issue from the past, they go through it, they write down what they would watch that week, they hand me the TV Guide, they have their list, and we talk about their choices. Sometimes it's less formal than that. We just kind of chat about television and the things we watched growing up and our sort of formative influences around pop culture. And that's basically what we do today with Steve. So for our final episode of 2016, please enjoy, I know you will, this amazing episode. If I know that's a little, I think it's amazing because I had a hand in making it, but it's an amazing episode, I assure you. Please enjoy this episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, the one and only Mr. Steve Albini.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Mr. Steve Albini, how are you, sir?
I'm good.
Thank you so much for doing this. I've always been a huge fan of all of the stuff that you've worked on over the years. And specifically, I wanted to talk to you because, and this may be a complete fabrication in my end, but I always got the impression that you may have been a fellow latchkey kid. Am I wrong?
If I understand the term correctly, that means both of my parents worked and I came home on my own and made my own lunch and things like that.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, no, that's not the case. My dad worked and my mom stayed home. We had three kids. There were three kids in the household and occasionally, foster kids as well. So my mom had quite a handful.
Were you watching a lot of TV and stuff at the time? And my impression of that you may have been a fellow latchkey kid was more, because a lot of the references and things that I detected in your work over the years, especially the Big Black stuff, and sort of the anime references and that, a lot of that stuff was prime after school television.
Yeah, when I was a kid, I watched television a lot more than I do as an adult. I basically shut television off around 1980, but when I was a kid, I watched I watched basically whatever was on. When I was a very small child, we lived in Santa Barbara, California, which was not a major media market, but had a couple of local television stations as well as all the network affiliates and stuff. Then I lived for a while in Washington, D.C., or in the suburbs around Washington, D.C., and there was an extraordinary number of channels. There were a bunch of UHF channels as well as the sort of small number of channels. I don't know what those are called. VHF?
Oh, yeah, VHF, yeah.
And then in the early 1970s, we moved to Montana, and the town that we moved to, Missoula, had two broadcast stations. As I recall, one of them was NBC, and then the other one shared time between ABC and CBS.
Which sounds insane now to people, probably, but was pretty common, especially in the Midwest.
Yeah, there were small towns where there was only one local television station, and sometimes the local television station was actually, the nearest big town if you could get it.
Right. You had to kind of get one of the siblings to go up on the roof and try and triangulate so you could get it. With that many kids in the house, were you guys ever sort of arguing over what you're going to watch, or was there ever a show that you had to advocate for? Because I always theorize that kids today, in my old man talk, are missing those sort of skill set where they had to advocate and compromise on television when we only had one TV in the house.
As I recall, there wasn't really that much competition. It was sort of like if you had a favorite program, you could watch it, but if not, whoever happened to get to the TV first, was kind of channel captain.
Right. Kids setting an alarm to get up at 5 a.m. so they could have the TV on Saturday morning or something.
I remember like the first time I saw a color television, that was pretty impressive.
Do you remember what you watched on it?
Yeah, my grandparents had built an addition onto their they lived on a farmhouse. In a farmhouse on an olive orchard where my grandfather grew olives, and in Madera, California. And this would have been like 1967, 68, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And they built an addition onto the house that was basically just a massive living room that had a fireplace at one end and a Barca lounger in the middle of it, and then a television right next to the fireplace.
That's an American dream.
Yeah, and my grandfather would sit in the Barca lounger and fall asleep every afternoon after consuming most of a can of packed in oil sardines.
Living the life.
Yeah, and he was very fond of the Lawrence Welk program, and that was the first thing that I ever saw in color on a television set.
And was that one of the first musical shows that you were sort of exposed to as a kid?
I don't remember it being musical. I mean, there was singing on it, but I remember it more for the variety acts, people like there were, plate spinners and bicycle trick people and, trick shot artists and all kinds of absurd crap on that show.
Yeah, it was all like holdovers from vaudeville and burlesque that we were still getting on TV when we were growing up, which again is completely bizarre that we got exposed to this, mid and early 20th century culture because it was just cheap and they could find them and put them on television.
Yeah, I'm regularly surprised that so many things that are completely dead now, completely gone now, were part of my upbringing. Things like, party line telephones and being able to click the receiver and get an operator and things like that. Like that sort of stuff seems like when you think about it now, it just seems absolutely archaic, like a telegraph, you know. It's like a kid riding up to your door on a bicycle with a telegram, you know. That might be the nearest thing. No, actually, now that I think about it, telegrams did exist when I was a kid. I remember because my dad got a telegram from somebody. It was sort of I think it was meant to be an ironic thing. He got a well-wishing telegram from someone. And this would have been in the early 1960s, like 66, 67, something like that. When I was a little kid, I remember my dad getting a telegram and reading it.
Yeah, I mean, even the stuff like, you know, like singing telegrams and that kind of stuff that just was fairly common. Or, you know, one of the things I talk about on the show a lot, too, is that the television that we grew up with, which, again, tended to be whatever they could find that was cheap. So we got, you know, old movies and Looney Tunes and all this
Mexican
stuff.
Mexican wrestling. Yeah. Like reruns of Zorro and stuff like that.
We got kind of an education about popular culture that I think is sort of missing post-millennium, even though kids have access to absolutely everything ever created in the history of mankind.
Yeah. But I mean, if you have access to, you know, exciting, you know, contemporary stuff that's, you know, really dynamic and really, you know, active, you're not going to search out the Little Rascals and suffer through like a half an hour of tedium just to see somebody make a funny face, you know?
Right. But I wonder, it might just be jealousy on my end as well, but when I think about the things that changed sort of my life, like I remember seeing an episode of The Young Ones on MTV in 1985 when I was very little, and The Damned were on it, and that changed my life. That was, you know, I was like, I don't know what this is, but this is everything I love in the world right now. And that was just purely stumbling on stuff. And so many people that I know, you know, those of us who didn't have like an older brother or like a cool friend that introduced us to punk rock or something, it was kind of just stumbling on these things. And I wonder where that lives now.
Well, I mean, kids still have friends and their friends right. will still turn them on to things, but they're likely to be turning them on to like some, you know, Instagram thing or, you know, or somebody who's got a funny YouTube channel, something like that. And even that, you know, a lot of that stuff is kind of crappy and homemade, but every now and again, somebody like gives you a breakdown of some popular culture thing that you wouldn't find elsewhere. Like no one's going to explain like the various iterations of the gay hanky code to a kid.
right.
No one's going to take it on himself to explain that to a kid. But if a kid needs that information, he can find it, you know?
Yeah, he doesn't have to go to the video store and rent Cruisin', which would be far more embarrassing. When you kind of gave up on TV in the early 80s, was it just because you were busy doing other stuff or it changed?
It coincided with me going away to college, and I wasn't going to buy a television set for myself. And then, you know, so for a brief period, I lived in a dorm and there was a TV lounge, and the politics of getting dibs on a television in a, you know, in a university environment full of fucking sports fans and stuff.
Yeah.
It's basically impossible. And even then, like, there wasn't really anything on television that I wanted to watch. You know, that was like the, you know, the end of MASH or whatever. You know?
That was prime Love Boat years.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't, 1980, like I wasn't about to get wrapped up in, you know, anything serialized.
Right.
I think like Dynasty had just finished or something like that. You know, the sort of shit you only watch if you have time to kill and you're at your folks' house, you know?
Right. Cause you don't want to talk to your family necessarily. So you can all stare in the same direction.
And I had no interest at that point. I had no interest in sports. So sporting events meant nothing to me. I had, there was essentially nothing on television I wanted to watch. And that persisted for a very long period. Like there were a few of the smarter TV dramas that kind of piqued my interest. And I made a point of watching some of them. Things like when The West Wing first came on, I remember watching that, thinking that was smart.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, basically television is for idiots and children. And I outgrew being a child. And,
right.
I like to think I'm not an idiot.
But have you watched any of the, as stuff sort of getting better as the, in a lot of ways, it's become a little bit less corporatized with the sort of streaming stuff? Has any of that stuff piqued your interest at all?
Well, you know, there's an incredible glut of it, and you can find somebody who will make the case that every single thing is the greatest thing ever.
Oh, of course.
You know?
Yeah.
So like it started with things like The Sopranos and The Wire, and you know, like, they're the greatest thing ever.
Right.
And I watched a few episodes of The Sopranos and whatever the I like seeing Goombas make fools of themselves. So I guess it had some appeal, but, and then things like The Wire, I mean, that's, it's like you know, it's like fucking Beretta or something, you know, yeah. Like there's not, you've got cops and robbers, and like the big breakthrough was that sometimes the cops are bad and sometimes the robbers are good. You right. know, it's like the fuck, you know, really.
And we can swear on TV too. It's crazy.
Yeah. You know, and then shit like Breaking Bad and stuff like that. It's like a lot of it just, it's just like, it seems like somebody would have a, like an idea that could have been made into a film, but if you serialize it and drag out all the uncomfortable parts so that there's like a shocker moment in every episode, then, you know, it stays in the consciousness, like public consciousness longer. And it's, you know, obviously more lucrative.
Yeah, absolutely. It's sort of shock value stuff. And I wonder, you know, I always got the impression, were you into tape trading and that sort of thing when you were in college? Because of like...
Only really, really informally. Like, back then, if you'd know people in another town, you wouldn't necessarily be able to get a hold of the records that they were listening to, but they could send you a tape. Like, I was friends with David Grubbs from Bastro and Squirrel Bait. Mm-hmm. And before he went away to college, he sent me a cassette of a bunch of interesting Louisville bands. And some of those bands became among my favorite bands ever. You know, bands like Circle X and the End Tables and mm-hmm. his band Squirrel Bait. There were demos from his band on there. Maurice. There was a band. What was that other band? Babylon Dance Band. You know, there were quite a lot of really interesting, unusual, not just for Louisville, but just genuinely unusual music that I would never have heard if I didn't know him and if he hadn't sent me that cassette. And that cassette was sort of like on regular rotation along with everything else in my record collection.
Right.
But there were very few people like that and very few things like that. But cassettes were a pretty common currency in the underground music scene.
Yeah, and I for some reason I associate with like zine culture and stuff a lot of like the sort of underground tapes of non-musical stuff, like the red tapes or like that, you know, I think of the Bud footage yeah. and that sort of
well,
stuff.
The video stuff was different. Like there was no avenue for seeing any video stuff. So people would send, I remember people sending fucked up videos to each other all the time. My wife actually had a show that she put on at a couple of different comedy venues where it's just called Fucked Up Videos, where people would bring in fucked up videos and they would play them and everybody would talk about them. And, you know, stuff like Bud Dwyer blowing his brains out. But then like that, it all sort of evolved from there. Like my friend Jay Tiller made a kind of a supercut of the Bud Dwyer videotape where it was Bud Dwyer blowing his brains out on a loop. That it's horrific when you see it, when you first see it, like the initial yeah. insult of Bud Dwyer blowing his brains out on camera is just mind bending. And you know, you just feel weak seeing yeah. something that horrific. Right. But by about the 30th iteration of that 4 or 5 second thing looping, it kind of becomes hilarious.
Yeah.
Like it's as a defense mechanism. You know, a lot of people were experimenting with that kind of an approach where you take something that's abhorrent or take something that's like unbearable, and then you turn it into something, you somehow turn it into something that you can manage that gives you some emotional distance from it, you know. And then not only do you know about the thing and have you seen the thing, but you've processed it in a way that you can't with just, you know, the initial shock of it.
Right. If you had been there and seen it in person, you couldn't quite handle it in the same way with that sort of power over the repetition.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff like that. And then there's just, you know, like truly absurd stuff that you otherwise would never see, like the Metallica drummer, like the Canadian dude in his parents' living room air drumming to Metallica. And that Metallica drummer thing, as fantastic and as, you know, hilarious as it is, was part of a longer videotape that this dude made, just him going about his day, where he like went on some preposterous escapade trying to break into his old grade school, and then, you know, was like mountain biking down a trail and eats it again and again, you know. Like the thing that people know about is the Metallica drummer portion of that tape, but the whole rest of that videotape, like he goes to his weed dealer, you know, and his weed dealer shows him his growing room, and then his weed dealer freaks out that he's being videotaped in his growing room, you know. Like a lot of stuff that you just wouldn't, you know, like it's a little window into into a weird little British Columbian slice of the Hesher lifestyle.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, as someone who used to seek that stuff out in the pre-internet age as well, that stuff sort of had a weightiness to it when you did get to see it, and it stuck with you a little more because you were sort of in, not a privileged few, but you kind of, other people who had seen those things, you had an instant thing in common. And
yeah, like I can't remember the number of people where a conversation began with like something talking about some fucked up video, and then one or the other person would say, "Have you seen the South Park video?" And right. Then you know, it would either be, "Oh yes, that's incredible," or "No, what's the South Park video?" And then then somebody would get another like 20th generation dub of the original South Park video.
Right, and people forget that started as basically a pre-internet viral video. They made that on their own, and then it just was talked about for years before they got that deal with Comedy Central. It was really the kind of the last version of that I can think of. As that world has sort of gone away, the point I was going to make to tie it to stuff like The Wire is I wonder if people like ourselves, sorry to lump you in with me, those shows are less appealing because the shock value isn't there, because we sort of came up in a world where we saw a lot of that stuff all the time anyway, and it was sort of lost its power.
I don't know. I just feel like every generation reinvents the wheel, and you know, when you can, you know, when HBO started throwing money out for these sort of limited run series, then that was their version of fucking Dragnet or whatever, you know.
Right,
and then
right.
Then now that there's like Netflix and Amazon channels and stuff like that, like sure as shit they're gonna have their own version of Starsky and Hutch or whatever, like right. You know, or the, you know, or Three's Company or whatever, like, you know, every stupid thing that you can imagine from the previous iterations of the television consciousness, there's gonna be one of those. I've for sure as shit sakes, there's going to be one of those. You know?
Absolutely.
And then there'll be like a porn parody of it as well. So
yeah.
it's like nothing ever changes. People are going to be fucking imbeciles and, you know, eat popular culture for all eternity. It's never going to change. There's you come back in 1,000 years, whatever like brain implant device people are using to instantaneously acquire knowledge, there'll be a version of fucking Three's Company and My Mother the Car on that as well, you know.
Oh yeah, I mean I always complain about that, you know, we literally have devices in our pockets that contain the sum total of human knowledge, and we're, you know, playing Sudoku on it instead of really, you know. I wonder what people could do if they weren't just using it as a distraction, but you know, I don't know if they're capable of doing, you know, anything with it, or only a few are. One of the things I wanted to talk about too was, so you were in Chicago in the early 80s, right, when you were going to school?
Yeah.
Were you sort of aware of any of that punk rock scare stuff? Because I know that like Donohue had that infamous episode he filmed in Chicago.
I had some friends who were on the Donohue episode. Steve Bjorklund from the band Strike Under was on that episode of Donohue, or Maury Povich, or whatever the fuck it was.
Yeah.
And, you know, like they were, when they're casting a show like that, you know, when they're like trying to find people to represent this scary new youth trend of punk rock, they're going to try to find like the biggest fucking yahoo they can.
Oh, yeah.
And put him front and center. And they did. They found like some schmuck suburban guy who was like had a mohawk and a Hitler mustache or whatever. And like, and that guy was their icon for this idea that they didn't grasp. And then you had people who were like serious about their art and their lives, and they were there trying to like provide commentary on it. And of course they're doing it from the margins, and so they just sound like they're shouting, right?
Right.
So yeah, I was aware of that stuff. No one in the music scene gave a fiddler's fuck about, you know, what Quincy thought about the right. punk rock scene, you know, or what popular culture thought about. We were all totally used to being marginal and outcast and like being made fun of and attacked. Like that sort of shit meant nothing to us. It wasn't like, oh great, more people will be coming to shows. It wasn't like, oh what a bummer, there's going to be more heat. It was a non-event.
Right. It was just more of the same. Because people forget that, you know, even in the 90s when I was in a punk rock band and things were slightly different, people would legitimately just beat you up for no reason other than that you were like a punk rock kid.
Well, that was the reason.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean... to me, not a reason, but to them, seemingly, you know, now you go to Target and the, and, you know, and the cashier has an MC5 shirt on, even though they don't know what it is, and pink hair. And it's a very strange world. I often feel like I'm in some sort of weird Twilight Zone world with a be careful what you wish for kind of thing.
I don't know. The stuff that gets normalized is the stuff that's superficial visual aspects and superficial stylistic stuff gets, you know, like there's a fucking Chips Ahoy commercial with the claymation punks where with their mohawks right. And that sounded like fucking Green Day or whatever. I mean, that's, you know, the oi, 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 Chips Ahoy. if that matters to anybody, then that whoever it matters to didn't get what was going on in the first place. Because, you know, you from the very beginnings when there was punk stuff, like you would see like a fashion magazine would have like a, you know,
Vivian Westwood or something. Or
fancy, somebody in a fancy skirt standing next to some guy in a leather jacket with a safety pin through his nose or whatever. It was like none of that stuff is actually part of the punk culture or was actually part of the punk scene or the underground that spawned punk and everything that came after it. They're just signifiers. They're just, you know, it's like,
right.
You know, it's like there are people who are deeply involved in something, whatever it is. And then there are people who adopt superficial aspects of that stylistically to try to evoke some of the cool or the charm or the interest that original thing has. And they're not the same thing. It doesn't, you know.
Right. Was there any television or movies that you thought captured punk rock well that was not sort of an exploitation of it, but was a good representation of it? I mean, one of the things I think of is USA Network used to have a thing called Night Flight in the 80s.
Yeah.
You know, and I saw like Another State of Mind on that and The Decline of Western Civilization and that kind of stuff, which...
Yeah, see, the problem is that the at its base, the thing that made punks and underground people animated was their absolute certainty that everybody else had got it wrong.
Right.
Right? So, like, when I saw Another State of Mind, I wasn't seeing it as an impressionable kid. I was seeing it as a peer, as another person in a band watching a charade of a band fuck up a tour in ways that none of me or my friends and I would never have allowed.
Right.
You know? Like watching that was like, it was like watching the Keystone Cops or something.
Right.
Like, and then that, you know, that dude with his big fucking mouth and talking to the camera all the time, trying to impart this fundamental knowledge. It was just insulting.
Right.
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 So now my wife is a few years younger than me. She saw that. She had a massive crush on Sean Stern and she loved that movie. She thought it was great. It showed how resilient punks were and what a, you know, how brave and daring they were or whatever. I didn't really get into it with her. I don't really know why she liked that movie. I'm projecting here, but
right.
But like when me and my friends saw that movie, we were laughing at Youth Brigade and at that whole scenario. Like
right.
We thought they were fucking imbeciles, right?
Yeah.
And the same with the Decline of Western Civilization. Like there were bands in there that were doing stuff that we liked and admired, but they tended to focus on the people who were the most fucked up and least had their shit together, right. And were the least like all of my friends who were being very productive and very self-aware and, you know, not concerning themselves with image, but concerning themselves with like getting on with the process of actually being in a band and making music and putting out records. There was a kind of a gutter celebrity aspect to the Decline of Western Civilization that really articulated the difference between the sort of Midwestern punk and music scene and the coastal punk and music scene, where those people really did feel like they were celebrities or like they were speaking for a specific audience, and that they were engaging in another kind of star system, another kind of show business, and it was all fucking funded. Like on in that Decline of Western Civilization, like all of those bands had backers one way or another. Like they had somebody dumping money into them, or they had a record label that was floating them, or, you know, they were like scamming somebody's parents,
right,
you know,
right,
like,
right.
Like that whole scene. The same with the Another State of Mind. Like somebody underwrote this massive expenditure of buying a fucking school bus and putting a film crew in it. Like the fuck, like where does that come from? That comes from something outside punk. That comes from the external world trying to latch on to something that is a small self-organizing thing, right? And there wasn't anything like that in the Midwest. Like, you go to Minneapolis or Indianapolis or Chicago or Columbus or Louisville or any of those places, and there was, you know, there was nobody saying, hey, let me write you a check so you can go on tour, or hey, let me, you know, let me put your record out for you. Like, right. So yes, those things getting out into the general culture, I think, shaped the general public's perception of the music scene, and it did show real people doing real stuff, which I think is great. That aspect of it is great. Mm-hmm. And there's some of the music and some of the people in both, in all those things are laudable. But at the time, if you're up to your neck in the day-to-day music scene and milieu and surrounded by people that you admire and respect and think are way smarter than you and that are being super productive and super active on their own volition and, you know, under their own sail, right? Or like their own path, like doing everything on their own.
Right. It's frustrating to see someone who is not working to that level resources.
And then you see like a totally risible version of it presented as, you know, as a sort of a distillation of your life.
Right.
It's impossible not to just point and laugh.
Right. Yeah. I mean, that's such a different take on it than I have. Obviously, like I said, I was, you know, like you said earlier, I was an impressionable kid when I was watching it. I mean, there are certainly things in it that were laughable even to me as a kid, like Mike Ness, you know, putting his eyeliner on, saying he does it to, you know, evoke empathy in the audience, and this like 16-year-old kid espousing his philosophy on that sort of stuff was kind of silly to me at the time too. But, you know, here in Boston, especially when I would be exposed to punk rock here, it was that very jockish hardcore scene we had at the time.
Sure.
And so when I was able to see bands that were seem more like kids or a little artier, that had a weird impact. And actually, one of the other things that was hugely influential on me was catching on Night Flight again, Devo's Complete Truth About De-Evolution.
That's a touchstone, because that is a totally fucked up thing that, like, that entire mentality, that entire perspective was invented by them for them. They like inflated it from nothing. They you know, every part of that was their creation and their execution, and it's one of the most amazing, absurdist things that's ever been made in the art scene in America.
Absolutely. And again, Midwest again, you have there.
Yeah. And the contrast between that and, you know, some kids buying a school bus and then failing to mount a tour, like the difference, you couldn't be more stark.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. There's no plot line in the Devo movie. It's an art piece. It's a visual art piece that kind of at the same, was lucky enough that the media at the time was hungry for content, and it kind of got through the system in a lot of ways, pretty unfiltered.
Yeah. You probably won't find an aware musician of my generation whose mind wasn't at least a little blown by seeing Devo on Saturday Night Live or whatever their first encounter with Devo was.
Yeah.
Devo were a truly unique band.
Yeah, and they managed to sort of they kind of fooled people. It was almost a Trojan horse in that they were kind of fooling people they were a pop group, but then they had this really strong sort of art message that came through, and a really dystopian, weird message.
Don't get me wrong. Like, they got used to being rock stars very quickly, and they started making awful music that catered to an audience that thought it had them figured out. Their creative output like hit the skids right after their first album, and you know, there are moments of brilliance from there on, but that initial, you know, their initial ejaculation of creative stuff in the late 70s through the, you know, probably through their first or second album, like that period was just unbelievably fertile. They were, you know, doing stuff in all different media. They were engaging on a political level and on a social level that other bands weren't. They were discarding norms that other bands were just discovering, you know.
Absolutely.
So their initial, you know, their initial explosion onto the music scene was mind-blowing and truly inspirational.
Yeah, and I see, you know, this parallel may be false, but even like the way they would deconstruct pop songs, you know, I see in some of the Big Black stuff too, like when you guys would do He's a Whore, stuff like that, where they're doing Satisfaction. Was that kind of a an inspiration for doing that, for that approach?
Very specifically inspiration to all the times Big Black tried to do cover versions, what we were trying to do was do something that was that would allow us to own a piece of music the way Devo owned Satisfaction when they did their version of it.
Right. Which was in a lot of ways kind of one of the most punk rock things you could do, was to take something from the previous sort of generation of rebellion and completely deconstruct it into something different that sounded almost like a completely different song.
Yeah, and I think, well, the thing that's odd is that, you know, those guys are from that generation. Like, Devo are significantly older than us,
right,
or than me, anyway. And, like, the Mark Mothersbaugh and Bob Mothersbaugh talk about being inspired by that sort of stuff. Like, they were at Kent State during the Kent State shootings.
Yeah, that's when, like, their hippie ideals kind of died.
Right, and so what they were doing with Satisfaction to me seems simultaneously reverent and like negating the notion of the suave cool guy by replacing it with the robotic nerdy guy.
Right.
And negating the idea of like the sort of
rock sex cool, god,
the cool lack of engagement that song has about it. Like, there's nothing invigorating about the original Rolling Stones version of it.
Right.
It's cool, and it has, you know, it has style and flair, and the Devo version is like reduced to like elements of noise that have been reassembled around a text, which seems to be being delivered by a person who doesn't grasp what he's saying.
Right. It's alien. You
know? So, yeah, on every level, they wouldn't have picked that song if they didn't like it.
Right.
And they were from a generation where that song must have meant something to them. But they were negating it and using their aesthetic to craft a piece of music that had the same title and the same lyrics.
Yeah, and it perfectly distilled that sort of that sort of Church of the Subgenius, Atomica, you know, the 50s sort of lied to us in a way that I feel like a lot of the more blunt punk rock at the time didn't necessarily convey to me as well.
Yeah, I buy that. I mean, there's explicit messages are either grasped immediately or and either you're in the audience for them or you're not. Stuff that's more abstract, like Devo, gives you room to interpret it, and eventually you come around to realizing why they did it. You know?
Absolutely. Was there anything that you felt captured your experience or your kind of scene as far as a movie or a television show or a document or anything that you felt was pure?
It's weird. There were several attempts. There was a book called Our Band Could Be Your Life.
Yep.
Which was not exhaustive, but thorough. You know, they talked to a lot of the people that I would have recommended that they talk to.
Mm-hmm.
They talked about a lot of incidents and a lot of interactions that I would have recommended they cover. And the thing as a whole, the book still rang slightly hollow to me. Like, it seemed like someone who was not a participant was trying to make an academic exercise of explaining it. You know, it was a kind of a mansplaining of an experience that I and my friends had.
It's like an anthropologist talking about a lost civilization or something.
Sure. And to the people in that civilization, their descriptions of their, you know, their rituals would seem ridiculous. So that was a valiant effort. A lot of people have gotten a lot out of that book, especially people who weren't there at the time. Even me, like, I knew all of the principles in that book. A lot of the experiences and a lot of the things that are described in that book were, you know, chapters in my life.
Mm-hmm.
And knowing all of those people and having gone through all of those experiences, some of it rang kind of hollow to me, you know, in that sort of anthropological sense, where like if a Dinka read a Westerner's description of Dinka culture, he would laugh at it.
Right.
Because it would seem so superficial and missing so much of the important stuff. Right.
Right.
So, but having said that, in that book, there are chapters about bands that I didn't know as well. Like, for example, the Minutemen.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I was an enormous fan of the Minutemen, and so I read that chapter voraciously. And I can accept that people who didn't know all of those other people reading about those other bands would have the same impression, would feel the same way about those other chapters, about those other bands. So I think it's, you know, I think it's with that sort of informed by that experience, I think it's probably the best there's been yet about describing the music scene in the 80s. Right.
Yeah.
There was a filmed documentary called You Wern't There, specifically about the Chicago punk scene and underground, specifically about the period from 1980 to 1990 or late 1970s to early 1990s.
It's like Naked Ray Gun era, that sort of.
And predating Naked Ray Gun.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And that seemed really, really good in that it was mostly interviews with people who were there telling their stories about what they did and why. And it was, I thought it was great. I thought it was endlessly fascinating to me. All of my friends who I thought were really smart and really well-spoken back in the day still seemed really smart and really well-spoken 20, 30 years later. All of the music that seemed super invigorating to me 20, 30 years ago still seems super invigorating to me. You know, it, like everything about it evoked that era and that scene in a way that I have not seen other filmed scene documentaries do.
I'll have to check that out. It's called You Weren't There.
You Weren't There. And it was done by a guy who was in one of the later punk bands, but he knew everybody. He knew all the principals.
Mm-hmm.
And so he got incredible access. There's really fantastic old footage of very early punk shows, you know, and a lot of the bands that were poorly documented in terms of records or photographs, they sort of got their due through the oral history of the other people who were involved. And then there were even some recordings and films of those bands, you know.
Oh, cool.
So, yeah, I thought that was... I thought it was great as a historical document, and I thought it was great as a means of evoking the sort of mentality that I was swimming in and at the time.
Right. I'll have to definitely check that out. I'll find it and I'll put links up on the show. I always ask musicians this, and I'm curious to see what your answer is. Do you have a favorite TV theme song? Because as kids, those tend to be the first music we have a power over and that we can revisit on our own.
Yeah. The song itself is awful, but I really liked the Speed Racer TV show, which was the American version of the Japanese show.
Yeah.
And the song itself is awful. The Go Speed Racer, Go.
Yeah.
But when I was a little kid, when I would hear the Speed Racer theme, I would get really excited that Speed Racer was going to be on television.
Well, it starts off with that amazing kind of that. It's like,
yeah, sort of, that's this very typical sort of Flintstones. I forget the name of the arranger, but the guy that did all the Flintstones music was a big influence on a lot of the cartoon themes of the era. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think he did the string arrangements for a Lydia Lunch album.
Oh, late weird.
Yeah. I can't remember his name, but then there, prior to Speed Racer, there was the same animation house did a TV show or a cartoon show about sort of anthropomorphized animals called Kimba.
Kimba? Yeah, that Disney ripped
Kimba
off.
Kimba the White Lion.
Disney ripped off shamelessly for The Lion King.
I'll take your word on it. I haven't seen The Lion King, but same deal. Like the theme song for that was awful. You know, Kimba, 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 Kimba the White Lion is his name. Like just really childish, really trivial. But when I was a little kid and I would hear that theme song, it would get me very excited because then I knew that there was a little block of UHF cartoons coming up that included, it was Kimba the White Lion, and then there was an Aqua Boy and Astro Boy.
I love Astro Boy.
Yeah. And all of those would come out in a block in the afternoon, like the immediate post-school, post-daycare period when I was a little kid. So when I would hear the Kimba theme song, I knew that whole chunk was coming up and I could blow the next 90 minutes in front of the television.
Yeah, that's you time now. And you could just sit back and enjoy. Have you ever revisited any of those shows as an adult?
I don't think so. Well, yeah, I remember. Yeah, I have seen a few episodes of Speed Racer and they don't really hold up. They're awful.
Yeah.
But when I was a kid, you know, I was excited by the whole, like, that was a time when there were, like, the gadget-filled adventure was a big theme in popular culture. Like, you know, Batman had all kinds of tricked-out stuff in his car.
Yep.
And, you know, the Green Hornet had a tricked-out car.
Even the Avengers and the James Bond kind of stuff.
Yeah, and there was also the Thunderbirds.
Jerry Anderson's supercar.
Yeah, all this stuff was, like, sort of dovetailed quite nicely with my, like, mechanical bent when I was a little kid, and so I was fascinated by all of these things. And when my parents got a new car at one point, I remembered my brother and I, like, randomly pushing buttons on the radio and on the dashboard, like, what, you know, when we were left in the car when my mom went in to get groceries or whatever, just randomly pushing buttons on the dashboard, trying to make the pistols appear or the oil slick come out or the smoke
ejector seat.
Yeah.
Well, the kids are influenced by television. It's true. Well, thank you so much for doing this. I really love talking to you, and I appreciate you taking the time.
Hey, no problem.
Here you go, in line, Steve Albini, just an amazing guy and has created so much fantastic stuff. Owns a studio in Chicago called Electrical Audio, where you can record if there are slots and you have the money in Chicago. As I said, by his records, they're a huge influence on me as a person. His sense of humor is very twisted and dark and funny and disturbing, and he's just an incredibly smart, talented guy. Once again, I want to thank you guys for listening. If you're a regular listener of the show or an irregular listener of the show, if this is the first episode you've heard, it means so much to me that you have taken the time to seek out this show and listen to it. This little thing that I do in my office here in my home is really ballooned into this incredible worldwide thing, and I love getting messages from you guys, and it's one of the things I'm most thankful for every year, and I look forward to having it as an outlet in 2017, where I may need it more than ever, and I will be going strong as long as I am physically able. Not that I'm ill, but I don't know why I said that. If you want to message me, you can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or at canadaicanread.com. iCanRead.com being my stand-up comedy page, where you can also purchase my album, The Vanity Project Volume 1 Hollywoodland, which I recorded almost a year ago out at Meltdown at the Nerd Melt Studios at Meltdown Comics. And I want to thank everyone who supported that record, tweeted about it, bought it. It meant the world to me that you guys supported that record so much. And if you are in the San Francisco area or the Bay Area or anywhere around San Francisco, I am honored to be doing a live edition of TV Guidance Counselor on Sunday, the 15th of January. I will be performing TV Guidance Counselor at 4:30 p.m. at Piano Fight, where my guest will be the one and only Mr. Frank Portman, also known as Dr. Frank of the Mr. T Experience, an incredible band. Frank is a super smart guy, author, has written a bunch of great books, and we'll be talking about TV we watched growing up. So I hope to see you there. Go to sfsketchfest.com if you want to buy tickets, and come say hello. It will be great, and I really don't want there to be nobody there. I know people will come out. People always come out, but it'll be nice to see you guys. I'll bring some goodies. It'll be nice to chat with you guys, and it is always a pleasure to meet listeners of the show. So thank you guys so much. I hope that your 2017 is manageable. Let's all hope that it's manageable, and we'll see you Wednesday for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
I mean, basically, television is for idiots and children, and I outgrew being a child.
Right.